I want to share this morning about developing spiritual resilience. I want to share some keys, three simple keys for you to develop, to employ in order to develop spiritual resilience. I'll expand on what I mean by that concept in just a moment. But let me come to the book of James, chapter 1 and verse 2 to 4. The words will come up on the screen behind me. Just follow through with me. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops and produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. That you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Something we need to realize is that God's purpose for us in this life, in this Christian life, is that we become spiritually mature. That we become spiritually strong, that we become complete. That's God's plan. I wonder if it's our plan. See, sometimes we come into the Christian faith and we don't fully understand what this purpose is all about. We come in with a mindset, we're just looking for happiness. We're just looking for the chaos to kind of be turned to order. We're looking for peace. And they're all good. That's all good. They're all good motivators to come to God. When everything's going sweet in a person's life, they often don't have a sense of need for God. So the difficulties and the challenges that we face that motivate us to come to God is actually a good thing at the end of the day. But friends, I want to tell you what. The reality is that the ultimate goal of your becoming a Christian is not for you just to have a happy, peaceful life. It's that you will become mature and complete, not lacking anything. You see, there's a picture that is used in the Old Testament, an analogy of an oak tree to describe what God wants to produce in our lives. It says that we'll become oaks of righteousness. What that's saying is, you see, an oak tree, they last for hundreds of years. And an oak tree can last upwards of 200 to up to 1,000 years. The roots go down to the soil. The tree grows strong, and it's an enduring thing. That's a picture of what God wants for you and I. He wants us to be enduring so that when the winds of adversity blow against our lives, we know how to stand. We don't crumble. You see, if your goal ultimately is just to live a happy life, you're a sitting duck for winds of adversity. Because even when some of the chaos that you might have in your life that originally brought you to Jesus, when that settles down, I'll tell you what, winds of adversity will keep blowing. New winds will come. You can't get through life without facing a few storms. Stuff breaks in on your life. It isn't your doing. It just happens. Tragedies happen. You know, job, work losses, all sorts of stresses can happen. But God's plan and purpose for us in it is that we be strong, that we develop resilience, that we develop spiritual strength. God's goal is that we become mature and complete. And His way of producing spiritual maturity in our lives, guess what it is? It's trials and testing. It's winds of adversity. You know, I don't want anybody to kind of get the wrong idea that as a church that we would preach a message of come to Jesus and you'll have no more problems. It's not true. That doesn't exist. That message doesn't exist. But the message of this church is come to Jesus and you will find strength and you'll find a new perspective and you'll find resilience and you'll find ability to stand against the trials and the testings and the difficulties of life. Because Jesus promises to walk through those things with us if we'll put our faith and our confidence in Him. So God's way of producing this maturity is that we would face trials and testings. In fact, as a Christian, you will find that you will face new trials and new tests that you didn't have before you knew the Lord. When I was working as an engineer years ago, I used to have trials of guys wanting to rubbish my Christian faith. I don't think that sort of stuff goes down quite so much in the workforce today because we've changed a little bit in our approach to, you know, religious freedom and all that sort of thing. But back in the 80s, you know, if you put your hand up and said, I'm a Christian, you know, you got all sorts thrown at you, especially when you worked in a big engineering firm with 150 other guys. But it was fun. We had good fun with it. And, you know, and it's really been great over the years to see guys from back then, and I'm still going for Jesus, and they respect that, you know. And sometimes they meet some of you guys, and they say, oh, I met someone from your church, you know, and that's pretty cool too. So thank you. You're backing me up. It's all good. But anyway, that was all kind of not in my notes, so let me just get back onto my message here. Now, by nature, we do not enjoy trials and tests. Is that true? By nature, we don't like it when winds of adversity blow, when stuff goes on. It's not something that we like, and yet James is telling us in the verses we just read, he's telling us to actually consider them joy. He's saying, consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds. What's that about? How something that's uncomfortable and upsetting life, how can you consider that joy? You know, either James was on another planet, or maybe there's another perspective we need to get. Because I happen to believe that there is, you can find joy in the midst of difficulties. And the Bible actually tells us, I don't have the scripture up on the screen, but it tells us that the joy of the Lord is your strength. So James is saying, consider it joy. Get some of the strength of the Lord for the tests. So what's that about? How do we do that? Well, it's all about the attitude that you have toward the trials that you face. If you see trials and difficulties as something that's against you, and something that shouldn't happen and that's upsetting your peaceful life, well, then you're going to have problems. You're going to have disappointment. But if you, rather than see it that way, if you begin to see it as a tool in God's hand, that he's actually establishing something in your life, it can change your approach to it. It doesn't mean that it suddenly becomes enjoyable in the sense, but you can find joy in the midst of it when you gain a new perspective of what God is doing. Now, I had a little moment with God during the last week, just in my prayer time, that where I was contemplating the weather. As I mentioned before, we were coming into the summer holiday program, and I was watching the weather reports really closely, you know, because what you really want for something like this is you want beautiful, hot, sunny days, no wind except on kite day, when you have just enough wind to get the kites flying, not enough to destroy them like we had. but the rest of the day is hot and sunny, especially on the wet and wild day when you've got the big slippy slide and the buckets of water flying and the water balloons. You don't want cold wind on a day like that, like we had. Okay, so there was aspects of the program that were kind of opposite to what we wanted. And I know this because we've been doing these programs for the last 20 years or so, and you get to know the kind of weather you need when you've been doing them that long. And so we've been praying this way, and I've been watching the weather reports, and every day there's that, you know, some of them was a little bit of a sun coming out of a cloud, but then it would say winds, you know, winds getting stronger. And then the next day it's a little cloud with rain, and then rain, and then rain, and then wind. It's like, God, don't you run the universe? Can't you see what we need here, God? Can't you see, God? Yeah, we know what we need, God. It seems you don't know what we need, you know. Does this sound like sometimes the way we interact with God? I'll tell you what, as I was spending this time with the Lord in prayer, the Lord began to speak to my heart, began to show me some things, began to speak to me about this. I felt the Lord begin to assure me that he had actually ordered the weather just as it was, and that his purposes would be accomplished through it. Not my purposes, his purposes. You see, we often approach life with our bunch of purposes. This is how it should be, God. Do you know that he has purposes that are different often to yours? They are higher than yours. They're better than yours. And we do well to take heed to this. And so what I found is that as I just had this strong sense that the Lord was saying, look, I've ordered the weather, it's going to be okay. The things that I've planned to do during the week, the way I want to touch this community, the weather is perfect. I just began to relax, and I began to realize, God, you've got it. You've got it. Faith began to rise in my heart, and I just began to relax, and I actually found joy. This is the point I'm trying to make. When I came to that place of just letting go and letting God, there's a great little catchphrase for us for 2017. Some of you are going to need this year to let go and let God. It's just going to be the way it is for you. But in doing so, you're going to find a joy that's going to carry you through. You're going to find that God's going to open your eyes to things that you would not have seen had you stuck to your own little agenda. You hearing me this morning? And this is what began to happen. I began to find joy. Now, you see, if we hang on to our ideal of how we think things should be, then we set ourselves up for major disappointment. Because there's a very, very high possibility it's not going to go the way that we think it should go. And when it doesn't, of course, then we get disappointed. Now, for some reason, and it's just our humanity, I guess, but for some reason, we seem to expect that things should always be comfortable and easy, and if they're not, then it's because of the devil. You know, the devil's upsetting my nice, easy life, and God certainly isn't anywhere in it. Friends, I want to tell you that God can be right in the middle of your trouble. You can be following God's perfect will and encounter trouble. It's not the devil. Oh, the devil might be being used to stir a bit of it up, but ultimately it's not his purpose. God's got a purpose through you. I remember preaching a message to our youth years and years ago, 20, or probably no young people in the church would remember it because you weren't even born then. That was how long ago it was. And I preached this message called, Honey, I Shrunk the Devil. How many remember that movie, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids? Yeah, now you're showing your age, okay? But and I got this inspiration actually from another youth pastor up in Auckland. He preached a message called, Honey, I Shrunk the Devil. Because sometimes we have this concept of the devil that he's this big, semi-all-powerful being. Do you know, when you commit your life into the hands of God, the devil actually becomes a tool of God. Understand what I'm saying there? Understand what I'm saying? I'm saying that when you put your hands, when your life into the hands of God, the devil doesn't have it over you. Even though he still might be actively doing stuff, you can rise above it because you're submitted to one greater. That ultimately will work out better if the devil didn't actually do that stuff because it's actually growing you stronger. You know what I'm saying? I've got more I could say about that, but once again, I'm getting off my notes. You've got a bad influence on me, you guys. You keep taking me off my notes. No, it's not really. Okay, so we have this idea that things should go easy and our life should be comfortable. But listen, Jesus said in John 16, verse 33, he said, in this life you will have trouble. But take heart, because I've overcome the world. In other words, when we're submitted to Christ, that trouble doesn't need to be our undoing. It can be our making. So if we expect everything to be comfortable and easy, we set ourselves up for great disappointment. And we miss God's purposes in it all. Over the years, I've seen far too many Christians lose faith because things didn't go the way they would have liked. In the way that they hoped. In other words, they lacked spiritual resilience. They lacked spiritual maturity. They lacked that strength that comes when you begin to allow God to work in your life through these things. The Collins Dictionary defines resilience like this. It says, the resilience is being able to recover quickly from illness or hardship. Being able to recover quickly. Now, I love this because it's not saying that you go through hardship and it just washes off of you and doesn't even touch you. No, it's about recovering quickly. Yes, when we face trials, it's nobody likes getting bad news, especially me. I'm a real sook when it comes to bad news. Okay, probably more than you. But resilience, spiritual resilience means that we're able to process that fairly quickly and get to a place of, but God, my eyes are on you. And recover quickly. That's what spiritual resilience will do for us. Friends, if we're going to make it to the end of this life with our faith intact, we need to develop spiritual resilience. We need to develop bounce back. We need to develop that ability to bounce back from what the world and what the enemy throws at us. How do we do that? Well, I've got three, I believe that they're simple, but they're profound keys that the Lord's certainly shown me over the years in my life that I believe that if we apply these things, it'll help us to develop that bounce back. And the first one is this. We need to understand God's ways. That's the first thing. We need to understand God's ways. The Bible, you know, as you read through from Genesis to Revelation, it's revealing God's ways. And sometimes you've got to dig a bit deeper to find out what's going on, because things can seem like paradoxes in the Bible. But you'll find as you dig a little deeper and as you study it and get into it, you begin to learn God's ways. The way of grace is one of God's ways. We sang about it in that beautiful song that we finished our worship set with. Excuse me. And the way of grace is just so foreign to our world. And yet it's one of God's ways. We need to, you know, you actually can't live in grace unless you begin to understand it as best you can and begin to accept it. Because if you don't understand it, you tend to reject it. We need to learn God's ways. Now, one of God's ways is that he uses adversity and hardship to grow our character and our resilience. It's just the way God does it. This is one of his primary tools for this purpose. So before we blame the devil for our trials or we jump to the conclusion that God's not in it, let's step back and ask ourselves the question, could this situation be one of God's tools to build my spiritual resilience? That's one of the keys for bouncing back. Not just rejecting it and, oh, this is terrible. And, you know, the first thing we want to do is ring up somebody who we can offload to, and that's all okay, but I think we need to come to a place where we actually come to God first and begin to say, God, you know, what is this something that you are, you know, you're wanting to build something in my life? Romans 8 verse 28, it says this, God works all things together for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. All of your trials, all of your difficulties and adversities, God promises that his plan is to work it for good in your life. Notice it doesn't say this. It doesn't say God is only at work when all things are feeling good and working together the way you want them to. Do you notice that? It doesn't say that. But sometimes we live our lives like that's the way it should be. We think that, well, as long as everything's smooth and going well, I know God's with me. As moments, trouble's coming, oh, God's not with me. The Apostle Paul, he's obeying the Lord, traveling to another country. The Lord's spoken to him in a dream. He's got to go to this place, and he's taking his crew with him, and they're going to share the gospel, and they get flaming shipwrecked. So where did that come from? How could that possibly be part of God's plan? Well, it was, and it actually caused them to get washed up on another island that they weren't planning to go to. So a few miracles happened. Paul shared the gospel with basically the king of the island, and a massive move of God hit that island, and the gospel came there. If that shipwreck hadn't happened, they wouldn't have been there. See, God can be right in the middle of adversity. If our eyes are on him, we'll get through it fine. So what is the good that God is working all things together for? You see, your good and his good are often two different things. Your good has to do with comfort and ease, and I'm just speaking here generally. You know, as human beings, we're all a bit like this. I'm like this. My good is that I would live with comfort and ease. But his good is to grow our character. His good is for character growth. The good that he's working out in you is spiritual maturity, strength, and resilience. So the first key, as I've already said, is we need to understand God's ways if we're going to build spiritual resilience in our lives. The second point this morning is that God wants to teach us that his ways are different from ours. They are different. In fact, it says in Isaiah 55 verse 8 and 9, as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. See, God's ways are not just different from ours, they are way better than ours. They are higher. And we need to understand this if we are to grow resilience. Now, getting back to the summer holiday program and my little quandary with the weather. As I looked at the weather forecast, I had visions of what happened last year. Now, for those that have been around here for more than a year, you will have heard the story. We had the summer holiday program, the massive big marquee set up there and everything. And on the last day, the wind started to kick up and some of the pegs were loosening. I got a call from Renee, and said, Russell, can you come down here quick? I was down at the office. I went down there. We literally had about 50 people hanging on to the sides of the tent, stopping it from blowing off the planet. It was really like the poles were flicking out, and I'm thinking, man, this is dangerous. And we had just finished our afternoon program. So praise the Lord. There have been, I don't know, 150, 200 people in there. I don't know, there's a lot of people in there. And they'd all moved out of the tent and gone home. And then the wind really got up and the thing started to go wild. So I had these visions. And, of course, seeing the wind, the way it was kicking. Hasn't it been windy this last week? It's just been, well, if I'm the only one that noticed it, it's been blowing crazy. And I had these visions of what happened last year. And I'm thinking, God, we might have to pack, because we had to pack the tent up early last year. And I was thinking, man, we might have to pack up the tent 2 days into the program, not the second last day of the program. And so I was having a bit of a whinge, I think I was having a whinge to God about it. Can't remember. Maybe I was actually doing okay. But anyway, I was worried that we were going to have to end the program early and that we could be endangering people's lives. And I thought to myself, but God has clearly shown us that he's with us in the way that this whole program and outreach has come together. Just the way the team came together, the supplies and the various things, it was phenomenal. We're all just shaking our heads going, God, you've done this. You've obviously got great plans for the week. So why this wind? God's got plans. It's going to be okay. But then I had this thought of, so how could it be his will if we had to take the tent down partway through? How could that be his will? Then the Lord reminded me that his ways are not my ways. His ways are higher than my ways. And I began to see ways that we could strengthen the tent so that we could make it withstand the Manawatu westerly. I began to look at the whole situation and think, you know, if we pegged those curtains down more solidly, the wind wouldn't come underneath, wouldn't begin to loosen the ropes, and it wouldn't cause the tent to billow so much. So we need bigger pegs, we need bigger tent pegs. So on Sunday evening, remember we had church in the tent last Sunday? Sunday evening, the wind was getting up. So I went out there and I just said, God, I need some steel to make some, I'm an engineer, so that's my thing. I need some steel to make some big pegs, and I didn't know where to get it from. And then the Lord reminded me that Robert over in the corner here, who runs the wood recycling plant, also has steel. And he said to me, come over and get steel whenever you need. So I went over there, and he had exactly the right amount of steel, the right size. I took it home, chopped it all up, welded up some more pegs, and took them down there. We pegged those things in, and I'll tell you, that tent was going nowhere. You know, and the cool thing about this is because I gotten over the whole thing of, oh, why the wind, but just kind of accepted it in a sense, it actually led us to problem solving. And I'm confident, I'm very confident that we learnt a few new ways of lashing the tent down. I'm confident that we can deal with the Manawatu westerly in future years. I'm not worried about next year. So that was one thing that the Lord showed me. The next thing I saw was that on the first day, we ran this, in the afternoon, we ran this craft program with these children. And we had like 70-odd kids in there. And it was howling gale outside, but inside the tent, it was so peaceful. It was so quiet, and the children were just beautiful, wasn't it, team? It was just so peaceful, and I got chatting with one of the mums there, and she was just so thrilled to have somewhere to take her children on such a windy, blustery day. God knows what he's doing. Suddenly, we had all these kids that come down to the tent, and rather than being cooped up at home with the wind and getting irritated, here they were, kind of like outside, but in an inside outside, you know? And here they were just going about these craft activities in peace, and it was just a beautiful afternoon. All these parents were just thrilled to bits with what their children were doing. And I was reminded, God, your ways are higher than my ways. You know what you're doing. You know what you're doing. Maybe if it had been a sunny day, those kids would have been down at the pool or wherever, who knows where, but they were at our tent enjoying this environment. Now, you see, we want to get it all worked out in our head the way we think things should go. And if they don't go that way, then we think God has let us down. Is this true? What I'm saying, do you do this? What we should do instead is commit our ways to him and ask him to help us discern what he's seeking to accomplish through the situation. It's exciting when you start to get this insight. Suddenly you sense that it's not all about, it's all up to you, but instead God is really in control. A sense of joy begins to fill your life as a result. I had an incredible sense of joy that day. God, you know what you're doing, and I'm confident that no matter what the weather does this week, it's going to be fine. You know? Friends, I want you to be able to live your life with that kind of joy. That's why I'm preaching this message. That's why I preach it straight and from the hip. You know? Because I know that this sort of stuff, this is what challenges us to grow, and it's what sets us up for a prosperous and successful future. Point number three, my final point this morning. In order to grow spiritual resilience, we need to practice trusting in the Lord. I know it sounds basic. I know it sounds like, nah, we know that, Russell. But let me just spell it out a bit, because I know that if you're anything like me, I need to be reminded of this. We need to practice trusting the Lord. Listen to Proverbs 3, verse 5. Trust in the Lord. This was one of our memory verses, actually, for the kids over the week. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Look at that underlined bit. And lean not on your own understanding. Your understanding is what will set your expectations up for disappointment. That's what your understanding will do. Your understanding will say all the days shall be hot and sunny, and it shall be no rain, just enough wind on kite day, and then we know God's in it. Don't lean on your own understanding, because your understanding is going to let you down. Instead, you need to trust in the Lord. Come to that place of realizing God knows exactly what he's up to, what he's doing. My understanding, as I mentioned, was that we needed hot and sunny days with no wind. But I became determined to trust God and not rely on my own understanding. Listen to this statement, this point here. You might want to write this down. Your ability to trust in the Lord is directly proportionate to the level of peace that you will experience in life. Let me say it again. Your ability to trust in the Lord is directly proportionate to the level of peace that you will experience in life. You see, people are looking for happiness. Everybody wants happiness, but do you know what I think we need more than happiness? We need peace. When you've got peace, it brings you to a place of joy. Joy goes so much deeper than happiness. Happiness is very much dependent upon the things that happen to you. But joy is able to take you through difficulties and trials that wouldn't normally produce happiness. And of course, peace is the foundation for that. These things are fruits of the Holy Spirit. When you give room for the Holy Spirit to be active in the situation, the fruit of joy and the fruit of peace will begin to manifest. Friends, I think that that's what the world really is looking for without really knowing it. And it says in Philippians 4, verse 6 and 7 here, it says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation by prayer and petition. In other words, presenting it to God, giving it, praying about it. With thanksgiving, it says, present your requests to God. In other words, pray about everything that happens, every situation. Don't be anxious, pray about it. In verse 7, I love this. And the peace of God that transcends or passes all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. So peace is connected with doing it in prayer. This is how spiritual resilience grows in your life. The fruit of the Holy Spirit begins to grow on that oak tree that you're becoming. Praise the Lord. So in conclusion this morning, let me just wrap it up like this. We've talked this morning about, yeah, thanks, Al. If you come to the keyboard, that'd be great. We've talked this morning about developing spiritual resilience. Let me just brief over those three points just very quickly. Number one, we need to understand God's ways. His ways are not our ways. He has a purpose beyond what we might be able to understand. The second point is God wants to teach us that his ways are different from our ways. They're higher. They're better. We go better when we give over to God's ways. And number three, we need to practice trusting in the Lord. I wonder what level of spiritual resilience is in your life today. You know, sometimes I think we just need to be honest. Well, I know we need to be honest. Not sometimes, always. We need to just sometimes ask the question, God, or of ourselves actually, you know, where am I really at? Where is my Christian faith at? Am I just kind of going through the motions? Am I just kind of, you know, just dipping my feet in the water of faith? Or am I willing to really jump in and really trust the Lord? Because friends, I'll tell you, unless you're willing to jump in over your head, all the teaching of the Bible and all the church services and everything is not going to amount to much. It comes down to you making a decision. Lord, I'm throwing myself on you. I'm going to make a commitment to spiritual growth. I'm not just going to dabble with Christianity. I'm not going to play church. We could do this real easy. And, you know, you look around the room, you wouldn't know who's doing it and who's not necessarily. Only you can answer that question. Is your faith really serious? Because if it's not, let me tell you this. You'll become a statistic of a person that lost their way. I've seen it happen far too many times over the last coming up 23 years that I've been pastoring. I've seen it happen over and over again. I think, God, something's got to change. Something's got to change. So at some point, we've got to get serious. I'm in this for fully. I'm not just in this to find personal happiness. I'm not in it just to make life better. Lord, I'm in it to fulfill kingdom purpose. Do you know that when you make a commitment to really follow the Lord, you will invite trouble? You know, you don't have to wait for it to come. I think of Pastor Mark and Janice Somerville, our missionaries up in Cambodia. 15 years ago, I think it was, they left Palmerston North and left the staff at the church here to go to Cambodia, and they were inviting trouble. Cambodia is not an easy place to live. But they're people who have discovered how to face it with joy, and they've got spiritual resilience, and they've just got nothing but praise reports for all their 15 years in Cambodia. God has been amazing to them. That's living for kingdom purpose. That's living beyond just, oh yeah, I just want to get my life so all the chaos is over. Nah, invite some chaos. Live for Jesus. You know, scriptures say they love not their lives unto death. Those early followers, those early believers. Some of them lost their lives for kingdom cause and they did it with joy. How do you lose your life with joy? You can only do that when you're living for kingdom purpose and you're full of the Holy Spirit of God. Whoa. Getting heavy now, aren't we? It's good though, isn't it? Praise the Lord. All right, well, let's just wrap this up. I want to ask you, how do you handle trials? Make a decision this morning to allow trials to grow your trust in God. Grow your trust in God. Father, we thank you for your word today. God, we thank you, Lord God, that at the early part of this year, you're able to challenge us, Lord God, with a message like this. Lord, that would really become a directional thing. Lord, I pray for every person here today and every person that would be listening to this message on the podcast or watching it on the video. I pray for everyone, Lord God, that's hearing this message, that Holy Spirit, you would begin to massage it in. Don't let it run off like water off a duck's back. Lord, would you get it in? Would you let it penetrate our hearts? Because it has the potential, Lord, to really grow us in God and grow your kingdom. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.